I'm here where endless meets the end. Do you see me? I'm hidden here again. Your whispers found its way. Back all the voices in my head.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is Tuesday, February 28th, 2017. And that's one thing. Forgot to clean the pocket change off of my desk. Oh well. Let's get started. So where we left off last night, we were playing around with some potential ideas, and wasn't really working so well. This is gonna be a problem. So what we need to do is, so we have a bunch of things we need to do. So the main one has been, it's actually a bit louder than it used to be. Let's see here. Okay. The main one being we need to, make it easier to move around the map. I'm not sure how easy that will be in the system we have now, because a lot of the things I can think of that would be a good interface would require back and forth integration between UMG and game code. And if people remember back when we upgraded 4.14, we basically went scorched earth on that because they changed some way of how I was handling the back end, and it wasn't really responding all that well to, game input versus UI input. So we basically, as I said, kind of went scorched earth on it, and had it be in the menu, input only, in UI only, in the game only, and when a spectator joined, we just force them to go game only as soon as the first move is made. That's a little hack we did, and unfortunately, if we start doing where we have both of them at the same time, like if we have, you're able to move stuff with a controller and click on some things with a mouse, or use a keyboard and click on something with a mouse or whatever, that could be a problem. We would need to change and fix that. The problem is, the reason why we didn't want to fix it last time is because I believe some of the parts where that occurred were in the bounce back and forth between setting up a round, going through the blueprints, coming back to C++, going to blueprints, back to C++, and that big trade-off thing happened. Handoff back and forth. That's an ugly piece of code, and I don't want to waste a whole lot of time doing it on stream, because that will take a significant amount of time. It should be reasonable if I check it offline and just fix it, and then, come back and be like, hey, so we have a new brain inside this now. Make some other back-end changes that would be fairly difficult, but can be done in a, 6 or 8 or 10 hour chunk on my own schedule, right? So that gets to be a problem. What do we do, right? I can't exactly do that and have everything be on stream. So the thing I'm thinking of right now is maybe, cutting back, because the idea was to have a proof of concept demo that'd be, that the game, show the gameplay actually worked. and released that for free on itch.io and Peace Perspective, the site I work for, and have people play it and then see if that draws people to the stream. The problem then is, I don't think without making some major changes, unless we just happen to have some really amazing hacks that just happen to work, which we've been having good luck with recently, but yesterday was a bit discouraging. We may have to basically have the finish for the stream be, you know, a version or two behind the finish for gameplay, right? So at which point, it's like, when do we cut it off? When do we say, okay, we can start start developing off of stream, and I don't know. And there's another wrinkle, of course, is I've been mentioning this a couple of times now for the last couple of months, is I might be getting a job very soon, another job very soon, doing software development. And that will be taking, like, the biggest chunk of my time so far. Like, you know, above work schedule, which is great. I mean, that would be, you know, a lot of good income coming in, stuff like that, but that also then has the issue of, well, lots of people hosting me, so who hosts me? Unreal Engine, hi! As well as Linux Gamecast, thanks for the hosts. So now we have to think of what do we do for that? Do we, like, when do we say we're gonna cut it off and take it off stream? I don't know. I mean, we'll still be doing the stream. Like, the stream's not gonna end. It's just, like, when you see end one video and you start the next video, there might be some changes that occurred in that time. And I want to know when I can start doing that. Judging by the poll that I released, like, 3 months ago, I think it was, about 10% of people, which was, like, one person, want to see everything done in stream. Everyone else, they either want the game or they don't care about seeing everything done on stream. They just want a good stream in general. I don't know, right? And so my plan right now is, as I was saying in chat rooms earlier, my plan right now is to keep going until I get confirmation back from the job opportunity, which should be about next week or so. Could be off by a little bit. It's, you know, can't exactly rush someone trying to hire you, right? especially when it's two layers deep, it's someone's trying to hire you and someone's trying to hire them. Anyway, yeah, someone's trying to hire you if someone hires them, but anyway. So there is that issue, and then I won't know, like, if I don't get a job or if I do get a job, I don't know which one would make me more likely to take Check It Offline, right? I don't know about that. If the job is something I can do and I still have a little bit of time left over for a stream and a little bit, then I might take it offline and just, you know, push it through, so that way when the job is finished, Check It will be ready to hammer down on, unless I get more contracts in the future. Or maybe the other way around, if I don't get the job, maybe it's like, okay, let's put all my eggs in the Check It basket for a while and see what we can do with that. So I don't know about a lot of that. I'm speaking from the webcam, being very brutally honest. So we will see, and for all I know, there could be someone else who comes up to me and says they want to hire me for something, or commission me for something, or whatever, right? So you never know about any of that stuff, so you can only make plans so far, but if you are watching this, my Twitter is on screen right now. Feel free to message me, either directly or through DM. I have my DMs open for at least... as of time of this recording, I've had my DMs open for a couple, like a year or two now, since they allowed it. So if you send me a message saying, hey, I would like you to, you know, keep doing it on stream, no, take it off stream and stuff, then I'll hear that. Won't say that I will do exactly what you say, of course, because it depends, right? Like, if I'm only getting the certain number of viewers I have now, something's gotta change, because this is not sustainable. Not by a long shot, right? but I would still keep what the fan base I have wants in mind as well, right? So there might be some other ways around it, right? More information's better if you're able to sort through it. So that's my thoughts. As for what we were working on yesterday, That was weird. It didn't pop up. What we did was we have sounds now, so we're giving stuff here. Okay, so a lot of people are saying if they, if I'm doing stuff off stream, they don't mind as long as I continue streaming, and I really like the concept of doing a stream. And you can see there's actually a problem with the input mode, because like I make my movement wanting to move to the other monitor, which won't affect people in the actual game, because I mean, they will only be having one window open. But I do want to fix it, first off, to make it easier to do. Come on. Part of this, of course, is to show what the... Oh, you're trying to take me out, aren't you? Part of this is just to show the sounds, but yeah. Come on. Should be screwed by this point. Yep. And there we are. Right. So we added the fairly quiet sounds. No music yet. So we'll see about that. Then what we did after that was we tried to add a little overlay to hover over the player's name, the opponent's names. Find something that would be easy to watch, so that way when you have a pawn and you have a whole grid of them, you can see, oh, this pawn, even though it's a certain team color, this pawn belongs to Alice. This pawn belongs to desktop, whatever, right? And then some, like, two-layer hash. or whatever. And you can see then whose pieces is whose, right? So... Yep, right. So, then we had a problem with, adding that, because we had to, manage it. I'm not going to explain this right, but anyway. We then had to manage it, with each piece, and I'm thinking that might not be the best option for it, so there might be some way where we can actually have, those things hover over the, piece by adding it as a component to the piece itself. Hopefully we can do that without making the blueprint subclasses. I think we could be able to add a blueprint widget as a component of a C++ actor without making a blueprint subclass of it. Yeah. So we'll be looking at that today. And then the other thing is about physically moving around the map quicker. That would involve a minimap, which is not... And this thing is, minimap has a lot of different functionality, and some of it's not really required for Checkit. It gives us a good idea of where all the pieces are, but it doesn't really matter all that much, because it's a turn-based strategy, so only one piece can move at a time. So it's not as big of a deal as like a real-time strategy where someone could be trying to sneak something around the corner of your base or something like that. You need to have that glance to see it all. Things will happen slow enough that you don't need that extra level of visibility. But what would help a lot with is being able to click on the map to move you to various places. Again, that gets to be a problem when you're talking about when you're talking about UMG, because then how would you control that? I mean, if it's a render buffer and you place it using objects in the level and you just find where in the object you're clicking, and if the UV coordinate and you map that to coordinates and then move it there, then that shouldn't be as big of an issue. Because that would be a click like you would in the game, you might have to click several times to move it somewhere. Like, you have to click several times to pick up a piece. But we'll have to figure that one out. It wouldn't be as bad as, like, we know that you can click into the map without having it be in the input mode of UI. Which is kind of what I'm trying to say. Then the other thing is, what if we have, like, for example, buttons of each spawn, and, you know, spawn 1 is associated with this person, spawn 2 is associated with this person, you actually have that panel down the side, you can then scroll and say, move me to that person's king, or move me to this object, and have, like, places that are, you know, normal places you'd want to go, and have, a like, that be a side panel. That would be interesting, that would be probably a good mechanic, design standpoint, at least for widescreen monitors. It would suck for portrait, but I'm not really concerned much about mobile for now. But then we'd have to deal with integrating UMG and internal movement at the same time, and like I said, we've been really hacking around that for several months now. I would have to really gut some deep things to make it work correctly. I'm eventually going to have to anyway, but that would be after a demo is released. Again, the question is, how complete a demo do we want? So let's get back into it. All right, so we have to go and look at for, G reference C++ V4. We can't do that because we need subclasses of these. So just do everything through HUD, but that would be, you know, that has its own set of problems. So I guess we can't really do it easily as a C++ component, or as a component for C++ objects then. So then we have to continue doing it with the actor, which gets to be a problem because then we have our logic, affecting new structs, which are compared to a list of actors, which then have actors associated with it, which would be, you know, a difficult thing. Let's see, so UE4, C++, blueprints, actor. So let's look over here, and let's continue following this tutorial. So let's see if it has some ability for it. Okay, so they create the UMG widget. That's all fine. And then next step, they set up the actor blueprints. And that's fine. They set up a blueprint actor and they give it a widget class and so on and so forth. It may be easier if it was able to be set as a component, so that way you can just, you know, poke into the object and mess it around with it, but... So there is no other set here. Let's actually look at this. So UE4, trying to think of how to get to a solution to our problems, right? And again, right now what we're working on is little icons of some sort on top of pieces. I might end up not having it be the player's name and just having it be the dot over the pieces that you own, because that's really the most important thing is well, either that or a number. So like for each team there will be number 1, 2, 3, 4 and whatever, and you don't need to know who's who on the screen, just that you know that this clump belongs to this person, this clump belongs to this person. That could be another way of doing it. In all cases, what we need to know right now is how to easily attach it to the objects, have it face the camera at all times, and things like that. So let's look at other people who do this. UE4, UMG. Let's do name tag tutorial. That sounds good. YouTube, that's always fun. Okay, let's see it here, so... Oh yeah, today there's a huge Amazon failure. S3 went down for about 3 hours, which is not all that big of a deal in all in you know, the grand scheme of things. However, that is a fairly long outage, right, for cloud services that run like a third of the internet. I don't care about this. I know how to deal with name in and out, I just don't know how about, yeah, widget component, name over the head. But they use blueprints, forever. So the problem right now is, like, I know how to create an actor. I know how to spawn the actor in the level. The question is, how do I then access that actor from C++? So being able to get all of the actors of that type, specifically the one that is associated with the actor that I have, but that's obviously going to be difficult. And, like, manage spawning, like, the actor and moving it with the piece as it moves around. And then also keeping it up to date as the events occur. There's a lot of ways to do that, but I'm trying to think of how, like, the actual link goes into that, where you can spawn C++ or blueprints from C++. How do I spawn a blueprint actor in C++? F object finder. Okay. Is this right? What do you say? Oh, that's in another language. That's always fun. And create a blueprint for the player character and set the weapons in there. Yeah, you can do that. That's very easy. The problem is, then I can't subclass it. right? Or in the case of a piece, which would just have the piece state, I can't then spawn it from C++. That'd have the same issue, right? So, And no, I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to the person, whatever. I'm talking to the person that wrote this, like, probably a year ago. 2 years ago. Actually, a little over a year ago. Anyway, that was the wrong answer anyway, regardless. Find blueprint C++, you need to import the blueprint class. I never know what the class is, I guess. Use subclass 7 plus 7, that's good. And the blueprint constructor. Okay. Oh, I gotcha. So we need to get the static class. We need to get the object of the class from the object finder and have that be our static class to spawn using spawn actor. Okay, let's try this. So that'd be in Visual Studio. Okay, so now we need to do. In piece.h, which we're gonna move over to the side here. Yeah, particle system, the particles object. Okay. New property. T subclass of. Actually, that would be a U widget. Oh no, I can't do that. Oh no, it'll be a actor, right? I'll just do the regular. We can just use a regular pointer. Subclass of a actor. Piece name tag. And then this is gonna be old, so we need to then use something else for that. Anything exciting for me in GDC 2017? Haven't been keeping up too much on it, actually. I've been pretty, you know, I'm not gonna say busy, but I've been kind of paying attention to other things, unfortunately. I have been working a bit on a post about, the Vulcan announcement, 1.0.42.0. That one's actually kind of interesting. I was figuring that would happen a bit later in the year. I was expecting SIGGRAPH, but I might not be entirely wrong because they also don't have it be. They don't have it. They don't have it as a actual supported specification yet. It's kind of supported, but it's in the. So how vendor extensions in Kronos works? Is there is at the very very bottom layer there is vendor extension, so NV for NVIDIA command list whatever, right? OpenGL command list or whatever, and then you know the other vendor extensions that are used for features that a vendor wants to put in and play around with, but it's there for NVIDIA, AMD, they don't have anything yet. Maybe they'll make something in the future. Intel, who knows, right? That kind of thing. And the vendors stick all those stuff in. And they have their own specification of the driver. And it's good. And over time, as the Kronos says, that's picking up pretty good. Then it goes to the next layer. And when multiple vendors pick up the same extension, there's a committee that accepts it and changes the name to multi-vendor extension, which would be EXT. So instead of NV, it would be EXT underscore whatever. Trying to think if there's a prefix to that. I think it's only the API, so VK underscore whatever, but I could be wrong. Maybe it's CH underscore? Anyway, I think it's VK. Anyway. And then after that, typically, it's then accepted into core. So it'd be KHR. And when you have KHR, that means that the specification is now managed by Kronos. It can be used by anyone in the committee and so on and so forth, right? That's kind of the idea behind it. I think it can be used by anyone, period. Anyway. And that's kind of the layers for it. It would be vendor, and then multi-vendor, and then standards body. They're actually adding a new one between the top two there, called KHX. So it went vendor, then EXT, now it's going to be KHX, then KHR. And KHX is ones that the vendor, like Kronos, sorry, vendor, that Kronos accepts into I'm a bit tired today, don't mind me. Chronos accepts into themselves, but they don't want to have it be finalized yet. They don't want to pollute Namesafe with a extension that will be used and people will love, and then we want to change something, so we make a new extension or new whatever. So they want to have the KHX extension be where they dump all those new features in, and people can play around with it, but it's never intended to actually be in a shipping game. And the reason for that, of course, is KHX will eventually be KHR if it works, and eventually Dido if it doesn't, right? Or change in some way if it doesn't. So it's experimental playing ground where people can take their offline code and mess around with it. But until it switches to KHR, it's basically Chronos saying, you know, don't put that in production code, and like slapping on the wrist, right? So that's kind of interesting for that. Vulkan has a couple of new ones, mostly for VR and multi-GPU. So one thing that DirectX 12 did a lot better than Vulkan, just say pretty much at all, is multi-GPU support. So in Vulkan, you can technically, if it works the same as OpenCL, which I think it does, you can technically create multiple contexts and, like, you know, share stuff between contexts, which would be the analogy to DirectX 12 explicit unlinked multi-adapter. I think they call it MDA now, which is basically, you know, developer, have fun, right? And then there's linked, linked implicit, which is basically SLI and Crossfire. DirectX 12 has one in the middle called linked, linked explicit, which is LDA. I'm not remembering the you know, little acronym for it, but anyway. Anyway, regardless, what the idea behind that is if you have a group of, like, video cards, you can send them a command, and the driver can manage taking a texture off of one and moving it to the other without it having to go through a host first and other weird things like that. I mean, I probably have to go through a host to get to the driver, but you get the idea. Unless, for some reason, I think NVIDIA's SLI Bridge can handle some of that. Anyway, regardless, there are some things like SLI Bridges and stuff like that. Yeah, of course it can. Yeah, so some things like SLI Bridge and stuff like that wouldn't really work in Vulkan, just because it didn't have that nil state, but they're adding that now. That is now an experimental feature. In case you're wondering why I'm kind of scatterbrained on this, is because I didn't exactly plan it. Didn't exactly plan to talk about this. I didn't do my research ahead of time. I'm going off the top of my head, my not too awake head, but that's not important. Either way, so yeah, so that one's interesting me a lot. It's gonna push Vulkan into a lot of the things that DirectX 12 had over it, even though they were all based on Mantle. There was a couple things that Microsoft pushed for, and now Vulkan has them in experimental, at least. There's an NVIDIA driver that supports it, but it's not a game-ready driver. It's a developer driver. So that would be interesting if you're developing, but it's not designed to be put in production games yet. But if it's released to the public, that means we're going to get it in games fairly soon. After they, I mean, not in actual games because it's a KHX extension, but I mean, developers are going to try it in their game a little bit, and they'll be like, yeah, it works for me, and then Chronos will be like, okay, well, rubber stamp it, right? So I might still be right, and it still might be SIGGRAPH, and probably Vulkan 1.1, but this is just my perception of what it looks like they were trying to do. But they threw me off a little bit with Vulkan 1.0.42 having all these amazing new features, and it's like, that seems like a very odd thing to add into a .. release, right? Anyway. So, F-Object Finder U class. We don't want that. We want it to be this guy here. Copy reference. Yeah, I'll just paste it again. I need to type in C at the end for some weird reason. Because why not? Okay, so now let's have this be a text macro. And then, on set team, which would probably be a stuff here. Add the player name. Last constructor. Let's do F object finder. And also, I can use tag load object. Let's try this. Class. What am I even doing? New class. Overlay class equals cast. Class. Static load object, U class, static class, null. And then this text here. I do pay attention to chat, yep. Sometimes it takes me a little couple minutes to, you know, see, but yep. I do. What's the question? Or statement. Oh, one too short. Seems kind of odd to be using static load object to load a static class of a static class. You have the U class, load the U class of U class, please. Doesn't even make sense. Get a blueprint class, static load object. So yeah, if you have anything to say, then go ahead. Thanks, Mir. Okay, well, that's simple, but not what I had in mind. Okay. Trying to get some people are just joining me. I'm trying to make a an overlay on that follows actors around on a piece movement and so on and so forth, which would have the list of name. The problem is that the piece has to be C++. And I'd want to use UMG to design it, so the component or other actor of some sort has to be blueprint. So you have to have the C++ manage blueprint code. For you know, let's look at Answer Hub. Which I should have put UE4 behind, but meh. We got where we needed to. Okay, so blueprints, accuracy C++. See if we can find something a bit more recent. Video. Other way around. Yeah, you class pointer to the blueprint and use it to so the spawn actor. Wait, class by class. What is that class? Possibly get blueprints at E class like that because blueprints don't exist at compile time. So you need E class at runtime. Now I do it F class finder constructor, only works there. Example there. You can edit in the editor. The problem is I'm not spawning the pieces that in the editor necessarily, right? It had to be done at runtime. Let's look at this instead. So UE4 alternative to F class finder. Finder. Let's use F class finder then. Okay then, you win. I was hoping just because it was very old that there was a new way of doing it, but we shall see. I love Answer Hub. And it'll be piece name tag class finder. Oh, you fixed for NVIDIA GPU, cool. What was wrong with it? Or I should say what ended up being wrong with it. teaches you to update your machine without cause. Yeah, sometimes that ends up being a detriment. And then it would be piece name tag class finder piece name tag class. I should have never updated the kernel, then tried updating the kernel. It was actually kind of funny. One of my first experiences with one of my longest running, I should say, experiences with Linux was after I got a my first one was years before that, but was one after I got a Creative Labs XFI SoundStorm sound card, and that was the only functional sound card I had in my computer at the time. I'm not sure why I wasn't able to use motherboard audio. I can't remember anymore. For one reason or another, I couldn't use it though, so let alone because the front panels were all messed up, but anyway. So I got that and I was starting to use it, starting to try to use it, but I had no audio, I did use motherboard audio eventually. So I had to unplug my headphone, put it in the back of the PC or something like that for a very long time. And also didn't have nearly as many connections and stuff like that. So I was dealing with it, and Creative Labs like, oh, we're gonna have drivers soon, It's like, okay, well, we're waiting, and like a year went by, and they still didn't have drivers for their own hardware. I just, said screw it, and I used motherboard audio, as I remember now. And then my 7900 GT blew up. It just stopped working. It was one of the ones with the weird voltage regulators that were a spec, but it is still used anyway or something like that. I'm not exactly sure of the details. I can't remember them, but I remember there being a known issue with that. I remember reading there being a known issue with that line of cards, and I had one of them that had an issue to the point where like overheated in post screen. So while it's calculating memory, it actually had dots in the screen. Red, green, and blue dots. So I ended up replacing it with a 8800 GT. I'm like, yes, finally, let's get rid of this. So I installed it, went into Linux, and it didn't work. And I looked up online and went from Windows, and it said that NVIDIA didn't have drivers for it at launch. It was coming soon. And immediately went back to Creative Labs and like, oh dear God, no, right? I'm not gonna have another video card for, I'm not gonna have a video card for a year in Linux, right? Turned out it was that Friday. So the difference between NVIDIA and Creative Labs in that case was a significant amount, over a year, and when they released it, you had to recompile the kernel, versus NVIDIA, which was, Friday we'll have it. So that was a positive experience after a negative experience, but, what you said, recompile the kernel, I just remember, the prompt I had with XFI, I tried, they're like, yeah, follow this build environment, I didn't know much about that at the time, I'm like, that's run out, failed, don't know why, right, trying to do that stuff while also doing a physics degree at the time, so that didn't work out so well. The computer, at least, I went back to Windows. Regardless, I was always going to do Windows anyway, dual boot, because video gaming, especially then, Windows would be where it's at, but I was still trying to use Linux just in general. Anyway, that was an interesting time. And I hope you found it interesting too in my, bland voice. No, I have to add static in the middle here. Okay, so now here, if piece name tag, else we then spawn the actor, actor. Actor. Temp piece name tag. I might even be able to just do it from here, but I'll just do it here. I actually probably just do it from there. Piece name tag equals spawn actor a. Piece name tag class and spawn params. All right, we don't do that yet. So many ways to spawn actors. Where is that? I think it was Mega Step Helper. I think it was, game state. Yeah, here we are. Get world spawn actor, spawn location. Here. Get actor location, get actor rotation. That's not gonna actually work. So class, location, rotation, and then the spawn parameters are default. You know what? Forget. I'm not gonna dick around with that. I'll remove some of the type safety that I guess. Either way, let's see how this works. So when set team is called on the actor, which will be at the game start, it should place player name, not the actual player name, but just like player name over the actor. If it does, then we're good. If it doesn't, I'll comment that out and make a build. Either way, we'll comment and make a build. Because we're almost done for today. We have a short show today because we started late. So it's not yet because it hasn't been set team yet. Set team is called, here we are. Okay, well, that solves our problem. Cool, cool. So now we, then... animate death. What's the destructor again for, before destruction? Let's do UA4 actor API. Because it'd be in here, called once the actor has been deleted. Virtual. Let's begin destroy, right? Was it conditional been destroyed? Let's actually look in the view object. Begin destroy, called before destroying any object. And run the big asynchronous cleanup process, okay. So, okay. Virtual void begin destroy. Override, and then create. Here, and that's original destroy. No properties. Okay, no parameters per se. Okay. So we're getting play. Whoops. Super begin destroy, because we can't screw up any of the super functions, and then if piece name tag set visible from okay, there we are. We have to do with this check in case for some reason. The actor is destroyed before the game ends. So let's try this here. Okay, so that would be good for a name tag. We can then adjust the height a little bit. We should actually do it right now. We can adjust the height a little bit, so instead of spawning at the center of it, it'll be spawn a piece half height above that. Actually, a little bit more piece half height, so piece half height plus 10 probably. And then we just need to make it always face the player. So, we'd probably have to scan the level for, or I mean, just get player controller as zero and then get the parameters off of that. That'd probably just work. No, it's just a pawn. Hmm. You get the pawn from the player controller. Yeah, what am I doing? Now you see what we do. We can have all of these, be here, put whatever data we want on it because it's just on a UMG widget, and deal with it like that. And ready for the boom. There we are. Okie dokie. It wasn't moving with it, by the way. I should check to see if it, even though it's not gonna move, should have checked to see if it would destroy when the actor gets destroyed. Effector spawn location equals get actor location plus f vector 0.f 0.f and piece half height or piece state dot piece half height plus 10f. That should work. Have a team emblem on pieces? Yeah, that could work too. What's your complaints? Oh, if there is no complaint, it works fine. Okay. So we're gonna test this one more time. So yeah, we can put whatever we want on the widget. Within reason, of course. I want, especially for the demo, I want to avoid accepting untrusted data from like images and stuff like that. So it'd have to be something internal. And I don't really want to make a lot of emblems and stuff like that. I'm hoping to have just a color. And the team color of the piece would make sense because it's already on there anyway. So it's not like you need more data for that. But kind of cool, nonetheless. So something to think about. So you can actually see the things spawn in, unless I screwed up, above each of the pieces right there. Ah. No. Did I forget? Yeah, okay. That was a problem. Here I go, getting a spawn location and just immediately dropping it as soon as we exit the function without ever using it. There we are. Should actually probably make it a bit higher than that, but oh well. Those are all different sizes, just because it depends on the size of the piece. Try one thing first before we quit for today. Now we have it in, let's quickly here. Widgets. Try space screen. Compile save. And let's see what happens. So instead of maybe it'll work out, so instead of having to orient it, I can just have it be a 2D effect. If Unreal Engine does that for me. Cross fingers, 3, 2, 1. Ah, that's interesting. It's basically what I want. Yeah, I'm gonna wanna have something, so that solves a lot of the problems. I'm gonna have to adjust the rendered size based on the size of the screen, but we'll deal with, or the zoom distance, but we'll deal with that later. But that's allowed here. Come on. There we are. Draw size. Figure it's going to be expensive. You need to affect. You should. I would just size. Lock the dynamic scale. Ah! Maybe some trapped squares that blows up the square and the king player makes that square unusable. What it sounds like you're describing is where you have one square in the map and another square that has a level event, so if you move a pawn on it, it'll blow up and kill whatever's on that square. Or whatever else over there. That could be level events. That doesn't actually have to be programmed in directly. You could just have that be for a specific level, which would be fine. We could do that. That's kind of the exact opposite of the siege idea we're having, where we had, or the drawbridge, where we have empty tiles and we open it up to it. I can go both ways. There's nothing stopping me from doing that. So yeah, you can easily do that. That would have to be a per level event though, so that would kind of have to be baked into the specific levels as see fit. I would have to see about certain, unless you want to make it a mutator where it's like some random one on all possible maps, but I think it would be much better if we have them planned in on a per map basis. But yeah, you can do that, no problem. Yep. Okay, so we're about to call it quits for today. Before we... Ram bonus square lets a player a piece change jobs. I gotta be careful with that, because that would mean I'd have to have a specific set of pieces in mind for any given level, which would make it difficult to extend later on, right? I mean, there would be possibilities for that. So if we have a level that accepts whatever piece you want on it, and you have a drop-down menu to give the player the choice, that choice can be based on the content folder as opposed to what the level was designed into. What you're describing is basically promotion and mechanic, and it's something I've already been thinking about, but it's difficult to think exactly about it when it comes to modding, if I allow modding in the future, if it gets popular enough to allow mods. I designed a piece state such that we can just ingest a new piece state and all of a sudden the piece is a new piece. But that gets into a problem with when you actually have it being a level event, right? The level event would have to pull something more general that would link to the possible pieces that are available. The biggest thing is the mesh of it, whether the pointer to the content browser is valid or not. It's hard to describe, but yeah, it could be difficult to do and control, right? Because you'd also want the map maker some control over what pieces to allow and disallow for that mechanic, typically, I think, at least. But if you do that, then you're locking yourself to and from the possible mods that are allowed. So if you add and subtract it, then the map wouldn't know and back and forth, right? But I guess it's not exactly, it's planned. Anyway, so thank you for watching, and I'll see you all next time. Oh, wait. Nope, never mind. I still have to do the build. Forgot about that. So we are going to comment this out, comment that out. Then we're gonna package a new version of chips. We commented out the two spawn things we had there, so we're not gonna spawn the tags in the level until we need them. So we're gonna do a quick test to make sure it works. Oops. Because there's no reason to have player name be hovered over each piece, right? And if this works, then we're going to package a build out for us to play around with off stream. For Windows, unfortunately. It'd be nice if Linux Packaging Manager worked just the same, but come on. Cool. So that seems to work as intended. Package project, Windows 64. Let's hide my folder structure, even though it's already been shown on screen before. And I don't really care, but you know. There we are. So we're now packaging a project for Windows 64. Then we're gonna do a quick test of it to make sure it built correctly, and then we'll call it quits for today. Windows no enter, register not folder copy. And then we will try that build, see if it works. Again, after we copy the registry map folder into it. It'll be a bit easier if we were able to have Unreal Engine generate a registered map folder and a map list as it runs, so we don't have to do a copy every time, but or have the packager actually pull it in. But we haven't set it up yet, because all it would be doing would be saving me a couple of seconds on each build. Now let's try here. Close down the editor. Let's close down Visual Studio. Let's do one versus AI, human versus Alice. Yes, allow access. There shouldn't be any name tags because we commented it out. Good. Now I can say thank you for watching, and I'll see you all next time.